welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, whether you're on-prem or in the cloud, CVP Erin Chappell shares her perspective on what you should know about when moving and operating your infrastructure and apps in the cloud. We'll take a look at real-world best practices and the latest tools and services that can help you to be successful and avoid the most common pitfalls. So please join me in welcoming Erin Chappell to the show.
Thanks, Matt. It's great to be on.
It's good to have you. Now, most people know you as the former leader of the server infrastructure team, so I think you can empathize with some of the audience that may still be trying to get their head around the best ways to use the cloud and just looking for ways to improve what they have running now.
Yeah, I absolutely do empathize. I think, you know, having run the Windows Server and now being in Azure Compute, I've made my own migration to the cloud. And like many of you, I've been figuring out the path to connect the two worlds of on-premises and the cloud where it makes sense. And I think it's a normal inclination to think that you need to take the cloud in its entirety. Like, it's just a binary thing that I'm moving to the cloud. And that can be intimidating because it's different than what you have on premises. But it's not an all or nothing decision, Matt.
Yep.
You know, you probably aren't going to move everything to the cloud. You have things that are going to be running on the edge, in your data center, in remote offices, branch offices, et cetera. And so the cloud is really a toolbox in many ways, both in terms of the services that it has, but also the tools that it provides for you to be able to consume. And so you can use what you need, and it's very about being thoughtful about how you can engage with the cloud and where you choose to use it.
Now, this is an interesting vantage point because you of all people understand what it takes to make on-prem operations successful and now cloud. So where should people start?
Yeah, well, as I mentioned, shifting to the cloud isn't binary. It's not a binary decision. And also, the good news that I know from my experience is that running, you know, the server compute and now Azure compute is that there's a set of expertise that all of you have and what it takes to deliver infrastructure and management and security that is completely transferable. So let me kind of talk about what I mean by that. How many of you are familiar with the Windows Admin Center? Right? Awesome. Great tool. If you aren't familiar with it, go check it out. Jeff Woolsey, I know, did a great session on it earlier. Mm-hmm. But that's a great way that you can take a small step to start to leverage the cloud and then use Azure as your endpoint. Right? So you can get into this WAN from any server in Azure and use the hybrid services that you need. So here, let's take a look. We have the Windows Admin Center here. Here's the Azure hybrid services. I'm going to click on Discover Azure Services. You can see I have all of these Azure services integrated. So I can connect my network using the Azure Network Adapter. I have Monitor. I can use Azure Monitor from right here. Mm-hmm. I can use Azure Update Management, integrate that into my on-premises for patching. I can simplify with Azure Backup. And then what's not in here and not shown today is that we actually have Azure Arc as well that's been integrated into WAC in the GA version that just went live earlier this week.
Yeah, so we've seen File Sync, we've seen Security Center, all sorts of great integrated capabilities through. And I'm glad you showed this as Windows Admin Center. It's an amazing cross-cloud and infrastructure environment for managing Windows servers anywhere, on-prem, in the cloud, virtual, physical. Now, it's a great example of how you can start to incrementally leverage those key capabilities in Azure. And we encourage everyone here, as you called out rightly there, to check out the show that we did a few days back with Jeff Woolsey on the Admin Center. Now, what are some of the things that people need to be cognizant of then as they take those first steps towards the cloud?
Yeah, well, I just showed you how you can extend what you have with Azure. And in fact, you have more options than ever, whether you want to expand upon what you have on premises or have Azure come to you. And mm-hmm. we'll talk about Azure Arc a little later. So the first tip that I will say is don't treat your distributed infrastructure as islands. You need to find ways to connect what you're doing so you can extend and evolve.
So how do people solve for that?
Well, if you already have your own data centers, think of it as another site that you need to connect your resources to. This means thinking about connecting things bidirectionally so that you can bring Azure capabilities into your data center. Now, foundational to all these bidirectional capabilities is networking. Even if you have just 1% of your network in the cloud, you're redefining that perimeter. And so here's how our network in Azure can become your network. You know, if you think about your on-premises data centers and across Azure, how we have a global footprint of regions and edges and sites, you know, we can literally connect your WAN for you. And as you start to build that bidirectional connectivity, this gets you out of the expense and the complexity of running your own WAN. Mm-hmm. You can really take advantage of Azure's backbone, our network backbone, and use Azure's global fabric as your WAN so that you only have to pay for that last mile connection into Azure. And there are lots of options of ways to do this. Right? Express Route allows you to establish your own resilient and secure private connection to Azure for your main sites. This also gives you the ability to leverage Azure's global network and connect your sites together. You can also connect to thousands of branch offices by automating the configuration and connectivity of your branch and sites at scale with the Azure Virtual WAN service.
Yeah, and we often take the network connectivity for granted, but it's not actually going to take that much time to set up in Azure.
You're gonna show us.
I'm going to try my best. Thank you. No pressure here. So here we are in the admin portal. This is the foundation. The network is the foundation for all things cloud experiences. So here we are in the admin portal, and if I click on virtual networks, and we scroll down to find one that I prepared earlier, Contoso Azure VNet, a famous company. And we'll immediately see a big long list of network devices, network interfaces, NICs, that are attached to this particular VNet. And you'll also see things like virtual network gateways and application gateways where we start to integrate with our on-prem network. And if we scroll back up and across here and look at DDoS protection, this is incredibly important because Microsoft runs and protects some of the largest online services in the world, like Xbox Live, Microsoft 365. And as a result, you can benefit from the same levels of protection and scale for your virtual networks. Now, basic DDoS protection's on automatically, but you can switch to standard to provide additional mitigation capabilities that are tuned specifically to Azure Virtual Network resources. So awesome stuff. Now, let's take a look at security. Quite important, I'd say. And when we click on it, you'll see immediately there's a number of recommendations directly associated to the network. So it's telling me here that I should be locking down my internet-facing VMs, and I should be adding those to network security groups. Seems like a good idea. And if we drill into one of these particular recommendations around subnets associated with an NSG, you'll see it's providing me with guidance around what we're going to be protecting against, specific threats, and how I can start to remediate. Now, if I click on the Take Action button in the bottom left corner here, I'm presented with some of the controls that I can use to make those appropriate adjustments. Now, one other area that's important to talk about here is firewall. And we could have configured an individual firewall for this VNet, but we'd like to do this all centrally. And something we just announced in public preview is Azure Firewall Manager. As you accumulate more networks and firewalls, this public preview is going to enable you to centrally deploy and configure multiple Azure Firewall instances that span different Azure regions and subscriptions. You can create secured hubs, as we'll look into in a minute, to essentially define and control network traffic destined for private IP addresses, Azure PaaS services, and the internet. And traffic's routed to the firewall automatically, so there's no need to create user-defined routes. And you'll see here there are three simple steps to get started. And so we're going to dive into what it looks like to create one of these secured virtual hubs. It actually builds on what you said earlier around the Azure Virtual WAN, because this is essentially an Azure Virtual WAN with associated security and routing policies configured by Azure Firewall Manager. And we use these to easily create hub and spoke and transitive architectures with native security services for traffic governance and protection. Now, all I need to do is provide some basic information, choose a resource group, give it a name, an address space, and I can choose to whether or not to utilize an existing WAN that we've created already or create a new one here. I can associate Azure Firewall Policies. I've not got any just yet. We'll go through those in a second. And I can also integrate with trusted security partners for familiar, best-in-breed, third-party security offerings to protect internet access for users. Now, with this secured virtual hub created, I can then start to create my firewall policies that I'm going to apply across a broad range of services within my environment. So all I need to do here is, again, provide some basic information, name, select a resource group. And then I can go into what should be familiar to many of you out there who've managed firewalls within your environment. So going to rule collection here. And you'll see all I need to provide here is some very basic information, name, the collection type. So whether it's going to be a, I'm just typing a name here. The collection type, the priority, highest priority, obviously. Network application specific rules. And then I'm into just allow or deny and choosing the specific rules that I want to define, of which I can define many as part of this collection. And finally, once I've finished this particular step and defined these particular rules, I can then start to configure the routing of traffic to my secured hub for filtering and logging. So you see very quickly, we've configured this virtual network and the surrounding infrastructure for a solid foundation to build on as you do more in Azure. And now that we've built the foundation and the house, what's your perspective on building out services and migrating services within the environment?
Now, the first common mistake that I see is that people take and apply their existing notion of what it takes to run on-premises infrastructure and apply that to the cloud.
Right.
So if you're coming from an on-premises mindset, the first inclination you'll typically have is that you want to over-provision applications, servers, et cetera, because their things aren't elastic on-premises. You know, it takes you time to roll out that new server. And you don't want to get that 3 a.m. alert that a service is down.
I don't.
Yeah, I don't either. And so you'll likely need less infrastructure when you think about that move to the cloud. And you've primarily architected things for that on-prem world. So my second tip is to really assess your environment for the cloud. Now, we have a free tool that you see here that's called Azure Migrate to help you figure out the right configuration for your cloud world. You could also use Azure Migrate to integrate with the most popular third-party tooling, things that you might be familiar with, as you go through the steps of assessment and migration.
Yeah.
And as you bring more and more of your mission-critical workloads like SAP to Azure, you can scale out. That's one of the things the power of the cloud does. And we just launched the largest size VMs with 12 terabytes of RAM.
That's
pretty
huge.
Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, once you're in the cloud, or if you've got a hybrid setup running for a few apps and workloads, have you got any tips about how to feel good about the operational state and how you manage costs?
Yeah, so one thing you see a lot both on-prem and in the cloud is once a workload has been brought over and running, you have the tendency to just declare victory,
yep.
Right?
I've made
and I'm
it.
Not saying don't celebrate. It's, you know, it's exciting. You've made the move. You've gone through that migration. But it's important to capitalize on all the cloud-native capabilities where they make the most sense.
Right, and one of those benefits of the cloud is that it does make it easier to optimize what you've got. But this is a huge surface area to explore. So practically speaking, where should people start?
Well, Matt, the question and the answer typically is, it depends.
Yeah.
There's infinite optimization opportunities, and there's lots that you can do with your data, for example, with advanced analytics and AI and tons of dev opportunities once you've advanced your footprint and connectivity in the cloud. That being said, I'm going to keep these tips scoped to the compute area. And so here, if you have apps that have those fluctuating capacity, which are perfect in the cloud environment, you might want to look at containers. Mm-hmm. Containers and Kubernetes open up a lot of optimization opportunity here, and especially if you like things like HA clustering for servers, this takes it to a new level.
Yep.
And plus, if you're used to VMs, the efficiency of containers is much, much better. And then on the process side, you can leverage DevOps to be more flexible and provide flexible deployment and development environments.
Right.
You know, imagine a world where you have no maintenance windows, and you can make those changes and roll them back without breaking anything.
And that sounds like a nice place to be. And
yeah.
With cloud-native and elastic infrastructure like Kubernetes, as you mentioned, the agility of apps and services is on a new level, too. And I'm going to show people here just what that looks like. So all we've got on my screen here is Visual Studio Code at the bottom half of my screen. And I'm going to launch Kube Control to list the nodes within my environment. Now, if you're not familiar, nodes are essentially workers, and in our case, they're VMs, but they could be physical, and I've got three of them. And then we're going to enumerate the pods within my environment, which is a higher level structure containing one or more containers. And then I'm going to list the services here, and we'll see what we've got going on here. Now, you'll notice here, if I go back to pods, I've got four running, three for the front end of our application, one for the back end. And if we look at these services, the middle one's the key here, because that's our load balancer that we've got within our environment that's used for essentially distributing traffic to the front end pods. Take a note of that IP address there. That's an external IP address of our particular application, our web application. I'm going to bring that up in the browser. So I'm going to go to that particular web address there. And this is our Contoso Freight application. Built it this morning myself. A lot of work.
Congrats,
a lot of work.
Matt.
But we're going to actually upgrade that application. We're going to refresh it now in real time while users are using it. So what we need to do is, firstly, I'm going to drag down in Visual Studio Code here, and I'm going to point this particular app, this particular environment, at a new index.html page. So I've made some edits to this front end previously. I'm going to save that, and I'm going to use a number of Git commands to actually start to merge that code with what we've got at the back end in our repos. So I'm going to do a git add to merge. I'm going to do a commit with the message of updating UI. So you'll see that in a bit more detail later on. And I'm going to push it to GitHub. So I've got a private repo up in GitHub where this is all going to be stored. And you'll see that's been pushed up now very quickly. And that's all done. So what I'm going to do now is establish essentially a monitor that's going to watch the changes to the pods as things are happening. So while that's happening in the background, let's open our GitHub. Let's go to our repo for the Contoso Freight. You'll see the four pods running at the bottom there, so nothing changing just yet. But not everyone realizes that GitHub's more than just a repo. It actually has workflow, build processes, actions in there. And what you'll see here in this pipeline view is we've actually started the actions that are going to kick off based on that push that we've made. So we see things happening in GitHub as we refresh. We see things happening at the bottom here with the pods. Things are just starting to kick off. So let's just refresh the page. And all of the build jobs are now actually kicking off. So because of that push, we're redeploying additional containers. We're going to replace the ones that are there. So as we see, things happening in the background there. Lots happening at the bottom there. Containers are being created. Previous containers are being removed and replaced. And as we continually refresh the page here, so we'll continue to refresh our web front end. Remember, we're replacing this in real time while users are using it. There we go. Boom. We've now updated the front end of the application. Straightforward, easy, and those containers and those pods have been replaced all through that push command that we published to GitHub. So Kubernetes, an incredible solution. It extends, obviously, to on-prem and other clouds. It's not just in Azure. And we've been hearing a lot this week about Azure Arc. So yeah. How does that help all of this?
Well, Azure Arc really brings us full circle. You know, earlier we talked about ways to extend on-premises to Azure. Now, Azure Arc enables you to extend the Azure control plane on-premises to deliver that cloud agility and management in your on-premises environment. And so it provides a consistent management and services layer that applications can then layer on top of. And it provides you with the most choice in terms of where you want to run your workloads, applications, whether they be on-premises or multi-cloud.
Awesome. Well, there's some great tips here, whether you're just beginning your cloud journey or whether you're looking to expand on what you've got. So where can we learn more?
Well, of course, check out Azure.com. It helps you get to the right place and explore the information you need. It's also your source for great technical documentation. And I want to call out Azure.com/migrate, which is our central migration portal that gives you all of the guidance around migration and tooling for you to start your journey to the cloud.
Yeah, lots of amazing resources there. And of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for all the updates. Subscribe and follow us on Twitter. Thanks so much for watching. Bye for now.